Welcome back to Stories to Explore, children. I'm Anne Marie, and this is Norfolk Public Access Station. I have a story for you from Beatrix Potter, and it's called The Tale of the Pie and the Patty Pan. Now, a patty pan is a little device that, well, people still use them, but people used to use them a lot to keep the crust high on a pie. It would be a little piece of metal that you would insert, and then you'd put the pie crust over it. Once upon a time, there was a pussycat called Ribby who invited a little dog called Duchess to tea. "Come in good time, my dear Duchess," said Ribby's letter, "and we will have something very nice. I'm baking it in a pie dish with a pink rim. You never tasted anything so good, and you shall eat it all. I will eat muffins, my dear Duchess," wrote Ribby. Duchess read the letter and wrote an answer. "I will come with much pleasure at 4:15, but it is very strange. I was just going to invite you to come here to supper, my dear Ribby, to eat something most delicious." "I will come very punctually, my dear Ribby," wrote Duchess. And then at the end she added, "I hope it isn't mouse." And then she thought that it didn't look quite polite. So she scratched out "isn't mouse" and changed it to "I hope it will be fine." And she gave her letter to the postman. But she thought a great deal about Ribby's pie, and she read Ribby's letter over and over again. "Oh, I'm dreadfully afraid it will be mouse," said Duchess to herself. "I really couldn't eat a mouse pie. And I shall have to eat it because it's a party. And my pie was going to be veal and ham, a pink and white dish. And so is mine, just like Ribby's dishes. They were both bought at Tabitha Twitchett's." Duchess went into her larder and took the pie off a shelf and looked at it. "Well, it's all ready to put in the oven. Such a lovely pie crust. And I put in a little tin patty pan to hold up the crust. And I made a hole in the middle with a fork to let out the steam. Oh, I do wish I could eat my own pie instead of a pie made of mouse." Duchess considered and considered and read Ribby's letter again. "Pink and white dish, and you shall eat it all. You means me. Then Ribby is not going to even taste the pie herself? Pink and white pie dish, Ribby is sure to go out to buy the muffins. Ah, what a good idea. Why shouldn't I rush along and put my pie into Ribby's oven when Ribby isn't there?" Ribby, in the meantime, had received Duchess's answer, and as soon as she was sure that the little dog could come, she popped her pie into the oven. Now, there were two ovens, one above the other. Some other knobs and handles were only ornamental and not intended to open. Ribby put the pie into the lower oven. The door was very stiff. "The top oven bakes too quickly," said Ribby to herself. "It is a pie of the most delicate and tender mouse, minced up with bacon. And I've taken out all the bones, because Duchess did nearly choke herself with a fish bone last time I gave a party. She eats a little fast, rather big mouthfuls, but a most genteel and elegant little dog, infinitely superior to Cousin Tabitha Twitchett." Ribby put on some coal and swept up the hearth. Then she went out to it with a can to the well for water to fill up the kettle. Then she began to set the room in order, for it was the sitting room as well as the kitchen. She shook the mats out at the front door and put them straight. The hearth rug was a rabbit skin. She dusted the clock and the ornaments on the mantelpiece, and she polished and rubbed the tables and chairs. Then she spread a very clean white tablecloth and set out her best china set, which she took out of a wall cupboard near the fireplace. The teacups were white with a pattern of pink roses, and the dinner plates were blue and white. When Ribby had laid the table, she took a jug and a blue and white dish and went down the field to the farm to fetch milk and butter. When she came back, she peeped into the bottom oven. The pie looked very comfortable. Ribby put on her shawl and bonnet and went out again with a basket to the village shop to buy a packet of tea, a pound of lump sugar, and a pot of marmalade. And just at the same time, Duchess came out of her house at the other end of the village. Ribby met Duchess halfway down the street, also carrying a basket covered with a cloth. They only bowed to one another. They did not speak because they were going to have a party. As soon as Duchess had got round the corner out of sight, she simply ran straight away to Ribby's house. Ribby went into the shop and bought what she required and came out after a pleasant gossip with Cousin Tabitha Twitchit. Cousin Tabitha was disdainful afterwards in conversation. A little dog, indeed. Just as if there were no cats in Sawry. And a pie for afternoon tea. The very idea, said Cousin Tabitha Twitchit. Ribby went on to Timothy Baker's and bought the muffins, and then she went home. There seemed to be a sort of scuffling noise in the back passage as she was coming in at the front door. I trust that that is not that pie. The spoons are locked up, however, said Ribby. Now, let me tell you what she means by a pie here. She means a magpie bird. And magpies are notorious for liking to pick up shiny objects and put them in their nests. But there was nobody there. Ribby opened the bottom door oven with some difficulty and turned the pie. There began to be a pleasing smell of baked mouse. Duchess, in the meantime, had slipped out the back door. It is a very odd thing that Ribby's pie was not in the oven when I put mine in, and I can't find it anywhere. I've looked all over the house. I put my pie into a nice hot oven at the top. I could not turn on any of the handles. I think they must all be shams, said Duchess. But I wish I could have removed the pie made of mouse. I cannot think what she's done with it. I heard Ribby coming and I had to run out the back door. Duchess went home and brushed her beautiful black coat, and then she picked a bunch of flowers in her garden as a present for Ribby and passed the time until the clock struck four. Ribby, having assured herself by careful search that there really was no one hiding in the cupboard or in the larder, went upstairs to change her dress. She put on a lilac silk gown for the party and an embroidered muslin apron and tippet. It is very strange, said Ribby. I did not think that I left that door pulled out. Has somebody been trying on my mittens? She came downstairs again and made the tea and put the teapot on the hob. She peeped again into the bottom oven and the pie had become a lovely brown and it was steaming hot. She sat down before the fire to wait for the little dog. I'm glad I used the bottom oven, said Ribby. The top one would certainly have been very much too hot. I wonder why that cupboard door was open. Can there really have been someone in the house? Very punctually at 4 o'clock, Duchess started to go to the party. She ran so fast through the village that she was nearly too early. In fact, she had to wait a little while in the lane that leads down to Ribby's house. I wonder if Ribby has taken my pie out of the oven yet, said Duchess. And whatever can become of the other pie made of mouse? At 4:15 to the minute, there came a most genteel little tippity-tap. Is Mrs. Ribston at home? Inquired Duchess in the porch. Come in, and how do you do, my dear Duchess? Cried Ribby. I hope I see you well. Quite well, thank you. And how do you do, my dear Ribby? Said Duchess. I've brought you some flowers. And what a delicious smell of pie. Oh, what lovely flowers. Yes, it is mouse and bacon. Oh, do not talk about food, my dear Ribby, said Duchess. And what a lovely white tea cloth. Is it done to a turn? Is it still in the oven? I think it wants another 5 minutes, said Ribby. Just a shade longer. I will pour out the tea while we wait. Do you take sugar, my dear Duchess? Oh, yes, please, my dear Ribby. And may I have a lump upon my nose? With pleasure, my dear Duchess. How beautifully you beg. Oh, how sweetly pretty. Duchess sat up with the sugar on her nose and sniffed. How good that pie smells. I do love veal and ham. I mean to say mouse and bacon. She dropped the sugar in confusion and had to go hunting under the tea table, so did not see which oven Ribby opened in order to get out the pie. Ribby set the pie upon the table. There was a very savory smell. Duchess came out from under the tablecloth munching sugar and sat up on a chair. "I will first cut the pie for you. I'm going to have muffin and marmalade," said Ribby.
"Do you really prefer muffin?
Mind the patty pan." "I beg your pardon," said Ribby.
May I pass you the marmalade?" said Duchess hurriedly.
The pie proved extremely toothsome and the muffins light and hot. They disappeared rapidly, especially the pie.
I think, thought the Duchess to herself, "I think it would be wiser if I helped myself to pie." Though Ribby did not seem to notice anything when she was cutting it. "Oh, what very small, fine pieces it has cooked into. I did not remember I had minced it up so fine. I suppose this is a quicker oven than my own." "Ah, how fast Duchess is eating," thought Ribby to herself as she buttered her fifth muffin. The pie dish was emptying rapidly. Duchess had had four helpings already and was fumbling with the spoon.
"A little more bacon, my dear Duchess," said Ribby.
Thank you, my dear Ribby. I was only feeling for the patty pan."
"The patty pan, my dear Duchess?"
The patty pan that held up the pie crust," said Duchess, blushing under her black coat.
"Oh, I didn't put one in, my dear Duchess," said Ribby. "I don't think that it is necessary in pies made of mouse."
Duchess fumbled with the spoon. I can't find it," she said anxiously.
"There isn't a patty pan," said Ribby, looking perplexed. You see, Ribby knows it's her pie. Duchess thinks it's hers, in which she had put the patty pan.
Yes, indeed, my dear Ribby. Where can it have gone to?" said Duchess.
There most certainly is not one, my dear Duchess. I disapprove of tin articles in puddings and pies. It is most undesirable, especially when people swallow in lumps," she added in a lower voice.
Duchess looked very much alarmed and continued to scoop the inside of the pie dish.
"My great aunt Squintina, grandmother of cousin Tabitha Twitchit, died of a thimble in a Christmas plum pudding. I never put any article of metal in my puddings or pies."
Duchess looked aghast and tilted up the pie dish.
"I've only four patty pans and they're all in the cupboard."
Duchess began to howl. "I shall die. I shall die. I have swallowed a patty pan. Oh, oh, my dear Ribby, I do feel so ill."
"It is impossible, my dear Duchess. There was not a patty pan."
Duchess moaned and whined and rocked herself about. "Oh, I feel so dreadful. I've swallowed a patty pan."
"There was nothing in the pie," said Ribby severely.
"Oh, yes. Yes, there was. There was, my dear Ribby, and I'm sure I've swallowed it."
Let me prop you up with a pillow, my dear Duchess. Well, where do you think you feel it?"
"Oh, I do feel so ill, all over me, my dear Ribby. I've swallowed a large tin patty pan with a sharp scalloped edge."
"Shall I run for the doctor? I will just lock up the spoons."
"Oh, yes, yes, yes. Fetch Dr. Maggoty, my dear Ribby. He's a pie himself. He'll certainly understand." And again, here she means a magpie bird, because of course they're all birds, but they're all animals.
Ribby settled Duchess in an armchair before the fire and went out in a hurry to the village to look for the doctor. She found him at the smithy. He was occupied in putting rusty nails into a bottle of ink, which he had obtained at the post office.
"Gammon? Ha ha!" said he with his head on one side.
Ribby explained that her guest had swallowed a patty pan. Now, gammon is a British word for a cut of pork.
"Spinach! Ha ha ha!" said he and accompanied her with alacrity.
He hopped so fast that Ribby had to run. It was most conspicuous, and all the village could see that Ribby was fetching the doctor.
"I knew they would overeat themselves," said Cousin Tabitha Twitchit. But while Ribby had been hunting for the doctor, a curious thing had happened to Duchess, who had been left by herself, sitting before the fire, sighing and groaning and feeling very unhappy. How could I have swallowed it, such a large thing as a patty pan? She got up and went to the table and felt inside the pie dish again with a spoon. There is no patty pan, and I put one in, and nobody's eaten pie except me, so I must have swallowed it. And she sat down again and stared mournfully at the grate. The fire crackled and danced, and something sizzled. Duchess started. She opened the door of the top oven. Out came a rich, steamy flavor of veal and ham, and there stood a fine brown pie. And through a hole in the top of the pie crust, there was a glimpse of a little patty pan. The Duchess drew a long breath. Oh, then I must have been eating mouse. No wonder I feel ill. But perhaps I should feel worse if I had really swallowed a patty pan, Duchess reflected. What a very awkward thing to have to explain to Ribby. Let's see, I think I will put my pie in the backyard and say nothing about it. When I go home, I will run round and take it away. She put it outside the back door and sat down again by the fire and shut her eyes. When Ribby arrived with the doctor, she seemed fast asleep. I'm feeling very much better, said Duchess, waking up with a jump. I'm truly glad to hear it. He's brought you a pill, my dear Duchess. I think I should feel quite well if he only felt my pulse, said Duchess, backing away from the magpie who sidled up with something in his beak. It is only a bread pill. You had much better take it. Drink a little milk, my dear Duchess. Gammon, gammon, said the doctor, while Duchess coughed and choked. Don't say that again, said Ribby, losing her temper. Here, take this bread and jam and get out into the yard. Gammon and spinach, ha, 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 shouted Dr. Maggotty triumphantly outside the back door. I'm feeling very much better, my dear Ribby, said Duchess. Do you not think that I had better go home before it gets dark? Oh, perhaps it might be wise, my dear Duchess. I will lend you a nice warm shawl, and you shall take my arm. Oh, I would not trouble you for worlds. I feel wonderfully better. One pill of Dr. Maggotty. Indeed, it is most admirable if it has cured you of a patty pan. I will call directly after breakfast to ask how you have slept. Ribby and Duchess said goodbye affectionately, and Duchess started home. Halfway up the lane, she stopped and looked back. Ribby had gone in and shut her door. Duchess slipped through the fence and ran round to the back of Ribby's house and peeped into the yard. Upon the roof of the pigsty sat Dr. Maggotty and three jackdaws. The jackdaws were eating pie crust, and the magpie was drinking gravy out of a patty pan. Gammon, ha ha, he shouted when he saw Duchess's little black nose peeping around the corner. Duchess ran home feeling uncommonly silly. When Ribby came out for a pailful of water to wash up the tea things, she found a pink and white pie dish lying smashed in the middle of the yard. The patty pan was under the pump, where Dr. Maggotty had considerately left it. Ribby stared with amazement. Did you ever see the like? So there really was a patty pan, but my patty pans are all in the kitchen cupboard. Well, I never did. And next time I want to give a party, I will invite Cousin Tabitha Twitchit. And so there you are, the tale of the pie and the patty pan. And I'll be right back. I'm just going to take a break and I'll start another story for you. Children, I have another story from Beatrix Potter. She wrote such wonderful stories, and they have such beautiful illustrations, as you see on the show. And now I'm going to read to you the tale of Jemima Puddle-Duck. What a funny sight to see a brood of ducklings with a hen. Listen to the story of Jemima Puddle-Duck, who was annoyed because the farmer's wife would not let her hatch her own eggs. Her sister-in-law, Mrs. Rebecca Puddle-Duck, was perfectly willing to leave the hatching to someone else. I have not the patience to sit on a nest for 28 days. And no more have you, Jemima. You would let them go cold. I know you would. I wish to hatch my own eggs. I will hatch them all by myself, quacked Jemima Puddle Duck. She tried to hide her eggs, but they were always found and carried off. Jemima Puddle Duck became quite desperate. She determined to make a nest right away from the farm. She set off on a fine spring afternoon along the cart road that leads over the hill. She was wearing a shawl and a poke bonnet. When she reached the top of the hill, she saw a wood in the distance. She thought that it looked a safe, quiet spot. Now, Jemima Puddle Duck was not much in the habit of flying. She ran downhill a few yards, flapping her shawl, and then she jumped off into the air. Oh, she flew beautifully when she'd gotten a good start. She skimmed along over the treetops until she saw an open place in the middle of the wood where the trees and brushwood had been cleared. Jemma alighted rather heavily and began to waddle about in search of a convenient dry nesting place. She rather fancied a tree stump amongst some tall foxgloves. And now, children, you may know that foxgloves are a flower, and they sort of look, they're sort of long and fan out at the, when they open up, they sort of fan out at the bottom, at the, and they bloom every 2 years. But seated upon the stump, she was startled to find an elegantly dressed gentleman reading a newspaper. He had black prick ears and sandy-colored whiskers. "Quack," said Jemima Puddle Duck, with her head and her bonnet on the one side. "Quack." The gentleman raised his eyes above his newspaper and looked curiously at Jemima. "Madam, have you lost your way?" said he. He had a long, bushy tail, which he was sitting upon as the stump was somewhat damp. Jemima thought him mighty civil and handsome. She explained that she had not lost her way, but that she was trying to find a convenient, dry nesting place. "Aha, is that so?" "Indeed," said the gentleman with sandy whiskers, looking curiously at Jemima. He folded up the newspaper and put it in his coattail pocket. Jemima complained of the superfluous hen. That's the one that doesn't want to hatch her own eggs. "Indeed, how interesting. I wish I could meet with that fowl. I would teach it to mind its own business. But as to a nest, there is no difficulty. I have a sack full of feathers in my woodshed." Now, what do you think those feathers are doing there, children? "You may sit there as long as you like," said the bushy, long-tailed gentleman. He led the way to a very retired, dismal-looking house among the foxgloves. It was built of sticks and turf, and there were two broken pails, one on top of another, by way of a chimney. "This is my summer residence. You would not find my winter house so convenient," said the hospitable gentleman. There was a tumble-down shed at the back of the house made of old soap boxes. The gentleman opened the door and showed Jemima in. The shed was almost quite full of feathers. It was almost suffocating, but it was comfortable and very soft. Jemima Puddle Duck was rather surprised to find such a vast quantity of feathers, but it was very comfortable, and she made a nest without any trouble at all. When she came out, the sandy-whiskered gentleman was sitting on a log reading the newspaper. At least he had it spread out, but he was looking over the top of it. He was so polite that he seemed almost sorry to let Jemima go home for the night. He promised to take great care of her nest until she came back again the next day. He said he loved eggs and ducklings. He should be proud to see a fine nestful in his woodshed. Jemima Puddle Duck came every afternoon. She laid 9 eggs in the nest. They were greenish white, and very large. The foxy gentleman admired them immensely. He used to turn them over and count them when Jemima was not there. At last, Jemima told him that she intended to begin to sit next day. "And I will bring a bag of corn with me so that I need never leave my nest until the eggs are hatched. They might catch cold," said the conscientious Jemima. "Madam, I beg you not to trouble yourself with a bag. I will provide oats. But before you commence your tedious sitting, I intend to give you a treat. Let us have a dinner party all to ourselves. May I ask you to bring up some herbs from the farm garden to make a savory omelet? Sage, thyme, mint, and 2 onions, and some parsley. I will provide lard for the omelet, said the hospitable gentleman with sandy whiskers. Now you would think, at the mention of an omelet, unless Jemima didn't know what that was, that that would have tipped her off, but let's see. Excuse me. You see, Jemima Puddle-Duck was a simpleton. Not even the mention of sage and onions made her suspicious. She went round the farm garden, nibbling off snippets of all the different sorts of herbs that are used for stuffing a roast duck. And she waddled into the kitchen and got 2 onions out of a basket. The collie dog, Kep, met her coming out. "What are you doing with those onions? Where do you go every afternoon by yourself, Jemima Puddle-Duck?" Jemima was rather in awe of the collie, and she told him the whole story. The collie listened, with his wise head on one side. He grinned when she described the polite gentleman with sandy whiskers. He asked several questions about the wood and the exact position of the house and shed. Then he went out and trotted down to the village. He went to look, he went to look for 2 foxhound puppies who were out at walk with the butcher. Jemima Puddle-Duck went up the cart road for the last time on a sunny afternoon. She was rather burdened with bunches of herbs and 2 onions in a bag. She flew over the wood and alighted opposite the house of the bushy, long-tailed gentleman. He was sitting on a log. He sniffed the air and kept glancing uneasily around the wood. When Jemima alighted, he quite jumped. Come into the house as soon as you've looked at your eggs and give me the herbs for the omelet. Be sharp. He was rather abrupt. Jemima Puddle-Duck had never heard him speak like that. She felt surprised and uncomfortable. While she was inside, she heard pattering feet around the back of the shed. Someone with a black nose sniffed at the bottom of the door and then locked it. Jemima became much alarmed. A moment afterwards, there were the most awful noises, barking, baying, growling, howling, squealing, and groans. And nothing more was ever seen of that foxy-whiskered gentleman. Presently, Kep opened the door of the shed and let out Jemima Puddle-Duck. Unfortunately, the puppies rushed in and gobbled up all the eggs before he could stop them. He had a bite on one ear, and both the puppies were limping. Jemima Puddle-Duck was escorted home in tears on account of those eggs. Well, she laid some more in June, and she was permitted to keep them herself, but only 4 of them hatched. Jemima Puddle-Duck said that it was because of her nerves, but she had always been a bad sitter. All right, children, I hope you enjoyed these 2 stories from Beatrix Potter. You know, you can buy Beatrix Potter's books, and you can get her books at the Norfolk Public Library. So thank you so much for listening. You have a wonderful 2015, new year, and I'll see you again for Stories to Explore.